Good morning. New South Wales has recorded 1,116 new COVID cases today and four more deaths. There was some good news, though, with huge numbers of people coming forward for both testing and vaccination. Mark Burrows joins me in the studio. Mark, talk us through the numbers today.
The case numbers, Lizzie, are just in a rut at the moment, still around this 1,100, 1,200 range, 1,116 cases. Four deaths, four women in their 50s, 60s, 70s and 80s, all were unvaccinated and all had underlying health conditions. Premier Gladys Berejiklian today was not backing off on this push, where she's saying that when we hit 80% in November, international travel will reopen and we will be able to welcome people home. There are so many conditions on that, though, but she's still pushing that. She's also came out very strongly today saying that at 70%, which we should hit in October, at 70%, pubs will be able to go out drinking, about to go out eating, so life will change significantly. She's gone from to and fro on this because the other day she was saying those freedoms will depend on the number of cases and the number of people in ICU, and those still remain high. We had 917 people in hospital at the moment and 150 in ICU, so those numbers are still very big. Today we heard from Dr. Amir Abu-Bir, who's a specialist at Bankstown Hospital. He's in the epicentre, effectively, of the outbreak in New South Wales, and he said there is a problem with communication with many members of his community. Here's what he had to say.
We still have some people hesitant about getting the vaccination. To those people, I say COVID-19 vaccination are safe and effective. This is not only our experience here in Australia, it's the experience of the world and all developed countries. Up until 3 days ago, there were 5.2 billion doses given worldwide. And we have a lot of data from all this number about the safety of the vaccines and the very low, narrowed profile of the serious side effects of these vaccines.
While the doctors got concerns about the vaccination rate among some communities in the southwest, as you said, Lizzie, 148,000 vaccinations in the last 24 hours, which is outstanding. It still puts us on this track of nearly a million vaccinations a week. Also today, Gladys Berejiklian won't be drawn, or won't be pinned down, I should say, on whether, when we hit 70%, whether the people in the 12 hotspot LGAs will enjoy those freedoms. Mm. She won't go that far, and she also will not provide details. She was pressed today on the worst case scenario. She says cases are going to get worse. At the moment, she's not going to put a figure on what that's going to be.
Okay, we'll have to wait and see. Thank you, Mark. Well, Victoria has recorded 120 new COVID cases on top of two deaths reported late yesterday. Despite the spike, the Victorian Premier will today outline the road out of lockdown six. Christina Hearn reports.
Well, the Victorian Premier has conceded there is a middle path between COVID zero and lockdown. That middle path was thrashed out last night with the Premier, senior government ministers and the Chief Health Officer, and we will get that detail today. However, the Victorian Premier has warned it won't be Freedom Day for Victoria. This will be a staged and measured easing of restrictions. It does come, however, as Victoria records its first COVID deaths since November last year. A woman aged 49 from Northcote and a woman in her 60s from Hume, both dying at home. Those investigations are continuing. But as we await the detail of this roadmap, Melbourne Lord Mayor Sally Capp says small businesses desperately need a plan.
The toll on business owners and their teams of not having some sort of clarity on the way forward is very deep.
I'm here at the new vaccination hub at the Melbourne Town Hall. This is opening today, initially prioritising those that are vulnerable in our community, like the homeless, international students and refugees. It'll initially cater for about 200 people per day, but that is expected to be scaled up to 600 as more supply becomes available.
The Queensland Premier has succumbed to mounting pressure to ease the pause on arrivals from interstate hotspots. Tim Avia joins us live this morning. Tim, what's been announced?
Well, Lizzie, there's a partial backflip of sorts. The ban was meant to go for another week on those interstate arrivals, but under mounting pressure about Queenslanders being locked out, the Premier in Parliament this morning says 50 Queensland families will now be able to come in from this weekend. The big question is, how do they get chosen? There are some desperate families out there we're still hearing from, like Darren Harris. He went down to New South Wales after his 21-year-old son lost his life. Tyron, he says he's been crippled by financial pressure and doesn't know when he'll be able to get back.
I stand to lose pretty much everything. I'm at the point where I might have to sell my car. Which is, of course, your only form of transport. Financially, it's going to ruin me. It's going to wipe me out. And then, I've had to pay for a funeral. I feel like I've been punished because my son died. My son passed away and, you know, I'm being punished.
Now, when that border ban was announced, there were roughly 5,000 people in home hotel quarantine here in Queensland, and opponents of this mover are saying that the 50 spaces being opened up are only about 1% of Queensland's hotel capacity. The Premier also today was questioned about Queensland's plan in reopening once we hit that 70 and 80% vaccination mark. The Premier again indicating it is unlikely we'll fully open up again, citing her concern about young children.
You open up this state and you let the virus in here, and every child under 12 is vulnerable. Every single child, if anyone has any children under 12 to zero, is vulnerable because they are the unvaccinated, Mr. Speaker.
So, Lizzie, for certainly an indication there that Queensland borders could stay closed for quite some time.
Tim Arvey reporting there for us. We have some breaking news from Melbourne, where a woman has been jailed for a maximum of 18 years over the murder of her aunt, respected greyhound trainer Karen Leek. Jessie Moore was heavily pregnant when she bashed the much-loved 69-year-old to death with a hammer at her rural property in Devon Meadows, southeast of Melbourne, in May 2020. Moore will be eligible for parole after serving 13 years. The Taliban has held mock funerals for allied forces in Kabul as the US president commended his military's exit from Afghanistan. Amelia Adams has the latest from Washington, D.C.
It was a defiant and defensive Joe Biden who addressed the nation here today, owning his decision to withdraw US troops from Afghanistan, while also blaming the former president, Donald Trump, who set that initial date and deal with the Taliban. He hailed the evacuation mission from Kabul as a big success and paid tribute to the US troops who were killed helping in that mission when ISIS-K struck, vowing America will keep up its fight on terrorism.
And to ISIS-K, we are not done with you yet. As Commander-in-Chief, I firmly believe the best path to guard our safety and our security lies in a tough, unforgiving, targeted, precise strategy that goes after terror where it is today.
He spoke as the Taliban continued their victory lap, holding mock funerals, parading coffins through the streets draped with US and British, French flags, taunting the West, while at the same time, the new all-male leadership celebrated victory at Kabul Airport. A Taliban spokesman telling Nine News today that Australia should never have entered the Afghan war. He says our troops died in vain. We'll have more on that interview for you in Nine News at 6.
A $1 million reward has been announced to help solve the brutal murder of a Melbourne teenager. 13-year-old Denise McGregor left her Pasco Vale home in March 1978 and never returned. The next day, her body was found on the side of the road in Wallen East. Police are hoping to speak to a man who used a CB radio with the call sign Lightning One around the time. The Prime Minister has marked the 70th anniversary of Australia's alliance with America, laying a wreath at the US Memorial in Canberra this morning. The event was to be marked with a face-to-face meeting between Mr. Morrison and President Joe Biden. The pair are expected instead to speak over the phone. The milestone comes days ahead of the 20th anniversary of the September 11 attacks.